हेलो हेलो कैन यू हियर मी। हाँ हेलो।
हेलो सर, हाँ
हाँ कैन यू हियर मी।
यस सर, यू आर ऑडिबल सर।
ओके। सो थैंक यू। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई मस्ट थैंक अवर पुदुवे पड़िक्कम टीम तमिलनाडु आईएपी for inviting me, and I'll be presenting a new concept in the management of epilepsy. When it comes to epilepsy management, we all know that the epilepsy treatment centers on anti-epileptic drugs. So when we have a fever, we give paracetamol for a symptomatic treatment, but then we will go to identify an etiology by different techniques, including culture, and you identify a specific etiology, give antibiotics, antiviral treatment, or an anti-inflammatory treatment, depending upon the etiology. That is the precision treatment. But when it comes to seizure, you have a symptom, you give anti-epileptic drug, it doesn't support respond, then you go for another drug like that, and you treat, and you think that you are treating epilepsy. But we know that just like we are treating fever with paracetamol, we are treating seizure with anti-epileptic drugs. And the choice for the anti-epileptic drugs for epilepsy is, when it is a partial seizure, we will give carbamazepin or oxcarbazepin, or sodium valproate, levetiracetam, lamotrigine, or topiramate. All these are equally effective in a case of partial seizure. Then coming to generalized seizures, we'll give sodium valproate, lamotrigine. And when it is an absent seizures, we'll give either ethosuximide or sodium valproate. Then when coming to other type of seizures like myoclonic and generalized tonic-clonic seizures, again, we can give levetiracetam, clobazam, or clonazepam. But this, as I mentioned, the symptomatic treatment. But there is a set of treatment options coming up that we call it as a precision treatment. That is because of the advances in the next generation sequencing, that is genetic testing, metabolic evaluation, and the knowledge of autoantibodies. And earlier itself, we were applying our precision knife by the surgical treatment of epilepsies. And furthermore, the genetic studies have helped us in identifying the pharmacological effect of a drug by knowing its pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, and prediction of side effects and tolerability by identifying the gene variants. So this, I'll just try to bring upon about this effect by some cases. Just see this case, which had a very characteristic type of seizures, which is not responding to usual anticonvulsants. But the description of the seizure, once again, I'll show you this. Here you identify the seizure. That is what is called as a fragmentary type of myoclonus. So this one is very much characteristic of a syndrome, which may be associated with an EEG pattern of burst suppression. In that, that means early myoclonic epilepsy with the burst suppression pattern. And later the suppression has evolved to a hypsarrhythmic pattern also. And the clinical examination has shown, we can see here, there is alopecia, there is peeling of skin, dysmorphic facies, etc. So, and again, see that skin changes, where again you can see the seborrheic dermatitis like pattern. And then we did a blood testing that was for a biotinase estimation, and it was low. And the patient was given biotin 10 to 20 milligram per day, and the seizures completely improved. Patient became normal. His development also has further progress. So this is a case of early myoclonic encephalopathy, where we can look for inborn errors of metabolism. So this is again a child with a birth suppression pattern. So whenever there is a drug resistant epilepsy is there, we can look for a specific vitamin responsiveness, and we can give either the biotin or thiamine, pyridoxine, etc., depending upon the responsiveness. Again, for that, we have different methods. For example, in this case, this child has presented with infantile spasm, epileptic spasm, where again, the clinical feature of a hips arrhythmia is there, and the triad of mental retardation, infantile spasm, or a developmental regression, and hips arrhythmia. We make a diagnosis of infantile spasm or West syndrome, and you give ACTH, start with 20 units per day. Usually I'll increase to up to 150 milligram per meter square. In those cases which are not responding to ACTH, or when there is a specific tuberous sclerosis detection, we give bigabatrin 100 to 150 milligram per kg. But you'll have to examine the patient thoroughly. And in this case, the child had an abnormal genitalia, short scrotum. You can see that the hypospadiasis and MRI showing a corpus callosum agenesis and other renal malformation. So with this clinical presentation, we made a diagnosis of Proud syndrome, and genetic evaluation was done, which showed ARX gene mutation. So these are the situations where you'll get various type of neuronal migration abnormalities. Some can have a specific treatment or at least a specific diagnosis. So by doing a genetic testing, we can have a specific diagnosis, precise diagnosis, and precise treatment. In this case, because the child had a corpus callosum agenesis, you see here, there are episodic bursts, which can be considered as a checkerboard pattern. They are again typical of a corpus callosum agenesis. And in this case, as I have mentioned, it was diagnosed as a Proud syndrome, and ARX gene mutation was detected. In this case, you can see that you may think it as an abnormal movement, but if you look carefully, you can see that these are the sequential seizures in a newborn. And now see, it has gone into tonic spasms. And if you look carefully, you can see that clonic movements also inside. And this child, which has presented as a early infantile seizures, we did because the seizures were persisting, you can see that child had an SCN2A gene mutation, early infantile epileptic encephalopathy type 11. And it is said that these type of gene mutation, SCN2A, are sensitive to phenytoin and or carbamazepine. Because usually in myoclonic or early infantile epileptic encephalopathies, we'll be giving either the sodium valproate, levetiracetam, and such drugs. But in this case, the patient responded to phenytoin. So similarly, when there is an imaging showing a unilateral heterotopia, see here on the MRI image, you can see here on the periventricular region, you are seeing nodular heterotopia, and the genetic sequencing here demonstrated a KCNQ2 mutation. So again, identifying a mutation has helped in identifying a drug, but again, we could not obtain it, but the drug of choice for KCNQ2 mutation is retigabine, and it is available in the net as Trobalt. So 200 milligram tablets can be utilized for the management of this type of mutations. And then when we find clinical evidences of a tuberous sclerosis in the form of Ashleigh macule or other features of tuberous sclerosis, when you do an imaging, where a subependymal calcification or nodule with the evidence of infantile spasm, we'll be going for drugs like bigabatrin. Or nowadays, we can go for a specific treatment to attack the etiology, that is the mTOR inhibitors, because here what happens is the dysregulation of the mammalian target of rapamycin, that is mTOR pathway. And you modify this mTOR pathway by giving everolimus, and the basic pathology itself can be tackled. And nowadays, these mTOR inhibitors being used in other conditions also, like neurofibromatosis, Leigh syndrome, etc. And even our drugs or chemicals like caffeine, curcumin, and resveratrol also has an mTOR modifying effect. And even the specificity of the vigabatrin in tuberous sclerosis is said to be due to a modification of mTOR pathway. So in vitro, it has found that vigabatrin partially inhibited mTOR pathway activity and glial proliferation in the knockout mice in vivo also. Then, so when we are considering these type of genetic epilepsies, we can say that there can be a precision treatment by going for a specific drug. For example, we are all aware of the SCN1A mutation in Dravet syndrome. Dravet syndrome, which starts as a febrile focal chronic seizures, progressing to myoclonic seizures, absent seizures, and developmental delay with extrapyramidal and pyramidal manifestations. When you identify the SCN1 mutation, definitely you should not be giving sodium channel blockers like oxcarbazepine, carbamazepine, lamotrigine, etc. But we have a drug that is thiopental. And thiopental can have up to 50 to 75% of seizure control along with the clobazam. And then again, you get a child with a Landau-Kleffner syndrome-like presentation or EEG shows continuous spike and wave in a slow wave sleep. Then again, usually we go for intravenous immunoglobulin or IV methylprednisolone. In such situations, if the patient does not respond, we can try memantin if the mutation shows GRIN2A, that is GRIN2A mutation. Memantin is, we all know that is used for management of dementia, and it is available in different trade name. Also, our cough syrup, dextromethorphan, is also said to be useful in this situation. So SCN1A mutation, we can go for thiopental. GRIN2A mutation, we can go for memantin or dextromethorphan when the manifestation is like a Landau-Kleffner syndrome. And similarly, when you identify a child who presents with focal tonic-clonic seizures with the autonomic manifestation, because many times we'll be seeing such children, and your mutation studies shows KCNQ2 tritragabine, as I have mentioned earlier. Or when you have a migrating focal epilepsy, Coppola syndrome, in that case, then the EEG shows epilepsy evolving from one side, then goes to the opposite side, again, maybe coming back to the same side. This sort of a migrating epilepsy occurring in a structural manner. And your mutation study shows KCNT1, then you can give punitive. So this may be used in such situations. And similarly, when you have a familial infantile epilepsy with a paroxysmal dyskinesia or a hemiplegic migraine or episodic attacks here, and your mutation study shows PRRT2 mutation, you may give oxcarbazepine and carbamazepine. So see their specificity and precisiveness for drug selection. Similarly, we have discussed about the SCN1A, where the fenytoin or carbamazepine may not be effective, but when you find SCN2A mutation with the JEFs, that means generalized epilepsy with the febrile seizure plus, or of an infantile spasm, of the early infantile epileptic encephalopathies, here we can give phenytoin. So that means, see, when SCN2 mutation, you give phenytoin or carbamazepine, and when it is SCN1A mutation, it is contraindicated. So that is the specificity. And already I have mentioned about when you detect a TSC1 or TSC2 mutation, we can go for everolimus or vigabatrin. And now coming to the next group of disorders, again, drug-resistant seizures you find, and you go for a specific drug. For example, you are getting an intractable status epilepticus in a newborn. You have a multifocal seizures, multifocal clonic seizures, EEG showing a pattern, which is again very, very erratic. You give pyridoxine. So similarly, you do a CSF estimation in an intractable case, and you get a high level of glycine in CSF, or the MRS shows a glycine peak. see at 3.56, then you know that is a glycine encephalopathy. Here again, you can go for a treatment with either with the sodium benzoate, or you can try high doses of riboflavin. Then this child who presented with the abnormal startle response, then again atypical absence seizures, later progressed to have a Lennox-Gastaut syndrome like presentation with the febrile seizures, status epilepticus, and then infantile seizures to the childhood epilepsy with language delay. So his 4-year-old child with a history of seizures. Here he had increased appendicular tone, truncal hypotonia, and right upper extremity dystonia noted with gait. EEG showed mild diffuse background activity only. But here again, the MRS showed, you see here, I have shown you the MRS here. I'll just show you this MRS, typical MRS. You can see that Hunter's angle where, see the NAA peak, that is at 1.2. So 1.2, you have the lactate lipid peak. At 2.2, you have the NAA peak. And 3.3, you have the creatine, choline creatine peak. So these peaks are the normal peak. The earlier case where I showed an additional peak of glycine at 3.56, it was diagnostic of a glycine encephalopathy. And this is the normal peak once again, lipid lactate peak at 1.1, 2.2, you have the NAA peak, and 3, you have the creatine, choline creatine peak. And in this case, you see, we have taken an MRS, and see NAA peak is there, choline peak is there, but creatine peak is missing. So that means this is a creatine metabolic abnormality. And this is the normal Hunter's angle. So that Hunter's angle is missing there. And so we supplemented with the carnitine, and child had some amount of improvement, because we can't say that by this treatment you can cure. At this juncture, that much treatment is not possible. And this side, you can see that who had a recurrent fall and atypical absences. Here again, you see that recurrent fall and see that is the ectonic seizures. Ectonic seizures. And along with that, he had multiple drugs for the control, but there was no control. But then we started the patient on steroid. Patient showed improvement. So naturally, we had to taper and stop. But after tapering, again, the child worsened, restarted. But then the mother started giving him steroid in a periodic manner. Because the child was getting seizures and there was improvement, we admitted the patient and studied the CSF and found that there was a CSF glucose, low glucose level. So I think in this case, what was happening was when the patient was given steroid, there was an transient increase in sugar, and that was improving the patient. So we did a genetic study, and we found that it was a case of a glucose transporter 1 deficiency, and the patient responded to ketogenic diet. So that is a specific treatment when you find a glucose transporter 1 deficiency. We have reported another case of an alternating hemiplegia with ataxia and intractable seizure. And we found another mutation, that was a mutation ATP1A3 mutation. And that case also responded to ketogenic diet, because it is again a variant form of a glucose transporter 1 deficiency, and this child had a CSF hypoglycorachia. Here again, identification of etiology has helped us, and the treatment was by giving ketogenic. So that means glucose transporter 1 deficiency, you go for a ketogenic diet, and that is a specific treatment modality. So there are various metabolic disorders. At least these 10 metabolic disorders you should not forget, because by giving a specific treatment, when patients present intractable epilepsies, we can manage them. That is B6 or a pyridoxal phosphate or a folinic acid dependent epilepsies, glucose transporter 1 deficiency, hyperinsulinism, hyperammonemia syndrome, DENCH, that is developmental delay, epilepsy, and diabetes, neonatal diabetes, then hyperexplexic syndromes, creatine synthesis disorders, serine biosynthesis, biotinase deficiency, cerebral folate deficiency, and bioterrin synthesis disorders. So just see what are the specific drugs we can give for each condition. For example, bioterrin synthesis disorders, where again patients get a developmental delay, intractable seizures, and chorioathetotic movement. You do the CS of terrins levels, and you can try L-DOPA and bioterrin. Then cerebral folate deficiency, you give folinic acid, that is 1 mg/kg/day. And when there is biotinase deficiency suspected, you give biotin. Serine biosynthesis defects, you give a diet which modifies the serine availability. And as we have mentioned, creatine synthesis disorders, you give creatine for the management. And when there is hyperexplexic syndrome, where there is a glycine receptor mutation defect, you give clonazepam, and definitely there will be improvement. And in developmental delay, epilepsy, and neonatal diabetes syndrome, actually, neonatal diabetes, this even though we give insulin as a mode of treatment in juvenile diabetes, in this case, sulfonylurea will be better, and child's diabetes as well as seizures can be controlled with sulfonylurea. Then glucose transporter 1 deficiency syndrome, already we have mentioned about the ketogenic diet. B6 dependent, that is pyridoxine dependent epilepsy, you give a high dose pyridoxine. PLP, that is pyridoxal phosphate is available as one brand, that is tetrafol plus is available, where a high amount of pyridoxal phosphate is available and you can give. Similarly, folinic acid, leucovorin factor is also available in those patients where are intractable. You can try folinic acid for the control of seizures. So that means whenever a patient present with intractable epilepsies, or when your usual armamentarium is exhausted, you will go by evaluating the patient. You go for a detailed examination. You make sure whether you are dealing with a specific epileptic syndrome or a non-epileptic syndrome. Are you giving a correct drug? We have found that some drugs are contraindicated and some drugs are facilitated. So try to identify. For example, in typical cases, we know that in absent seizures, don't give carbamazepine. And again, in a complex partial seizure, idiosaximide will not be good. But in absent seizure, idiosaximide will be good. And are you giving the correct dosage? If not, adjust the dosage. Is the patient compliant? So identify that always. And then look for the activities of daily living, because many a times intractable epilepsy is just because the child is not sleeping properly. Child is not taking food properly. That itself can aggravate seizures. So that means whenever you get a pharmacoresistant epilepsy, reevaluate the patient in this manner. And if that is not there, you go for a reinvestigation by doing genetic studies, etc. And sometimes a rational polypharmacy may be helpful. For example, you are giving sodium valproate for a patient with absent seizures, and patient is not responding. Nowadays, idiosaximide is available, so you can change out idiosaximide. But idiosaximide is not available, then you add lamotrigine. There are synergistic effect will be very much helpful in controlling the seizure. So that absent seizure. So that means a selective polypharmacy also will be useful in the management of an intractable epilepsy. In certain syndromes, as I have mentioned, Dravet syndrome, where the sodium channel blockers are not useful, you can go for drugs like valproate, benzodiazepines, or clonazepam. Ketogenic diet, and you may go for even styripentol if you find a SCN1A mutation. And very rarely, if you are possibly able to get felbamate, then you can give felbamate for the management of Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. And finally, as I mentioned, you can go for a specific treatment. For example, in tuberous sclerosis, you can everolimus. It is available as Afinitor. And newer treatment modalities in tuberous sclerosis like clozapine N-oxide, which suppresses the focal seizures, also can be utilized. So, and going to the last aspect of my talk, that this is a 12-year-old boy who had a recurrent episode of unresponding sinus, chewing movements, hand twisting, drooling, etc. And just see the video. Okay, this is a case of a complex partial seizure. Again, you know that some may respond, but some may not respond. And in this case, the child presented with the status epileptic. You see the seizures evolving. Started as a spike and wave activity there. Then it has spread bilaterally and continued into a status epilepticus. See the evolution. And his MRI showed a lesion in the medial temporal lobe. Usually in older children and adults, you'll get a medial temporal sclerosis as this manifested. But this was a ganglioglioma, and we did a surgery and his seizures controlled. That means surgical aspect, you precisely diagnose, you do the excision, and the patient improves. So to medial temporal sclerosis is another situation where you can go for a surgery. And this was a 13-year-old female with intractable seizures since the age of 7 years. And initial, see the CT scan or MRI may not show the exact abnormality, but you go for a 3 Tesla MRI, and there you have the focal cortical dysplasia. And so once you identify this, you go for a resection. And you see it is resected, and the patient got improvement in the seizures. So identify the etiology and go for the precision. So that means that was a focal cortical dysplasia resection, and the patient improved. So really drug-resistant epilepsies, some can be surgically treated. So the surgeries are possible, especially specifically to possible in focal cortical dysplasia, medial temporal sclerosis, and DNET, that is dysembryoplastic new rectodermal tumors. In that also, you can have a specific treatment. But again, you all know that whatever I have discussed are rarely available, they are costly. So maybe you may prescribe it in our situation, it's quite serious. Take this medicine when it is available and whenever you can afford it. That may be the situation, but we may have later situations where you can go for all these sort of treatment whenever there is an intractable epilepsy. So newer AEDs, surgical modalities, vagal nerve stimulation, and other sort of treatment also will be helpful. Okay, to conclude, I must say that whenever you encounter a patient with intractable epilepsy, retake the examination, retake the history, redo the examination, and you go for a systematic analysis of the results. And if possible, go for a genetic analysis, and you do utilize current and appropriate protocol for the treatment. So if possible, the precision treatment in epilepsy that I have discussed three aspects: the genetic seizures, where the identification of specific mutation helping in you to identify the possible drug and the pathogenesis of epilepsy, and identifying an underlying metabolic problem. So you can correct that metabolic problem by giving some drug or some vitamin, or you go for a ketogenic diet, or you give kind of substances like creatine, which will help in the management of the seizures. And finally, we try to identify an etiology by doing a specific MRI. And MRI parameters, changing the parameters will help in identifying a surgical cause. And with that, you can do the resection, and thus also you can give a treatment. So that means an individualized treatment, that is a personalized therapeutic approach. That is what is called as a precision medicine is going to come in our scenario also. But again, as I have mentioned, this precision medicine may take more time. When all these investigations are made universally available, interpretation becomes more accurate, and when these drugs are available in our country also. So we may have a long way to obtain full integration of precision medicine into clinical practice. But awareness for the pediatricians is a very, very important thing. And understand that we are going into the era of personalized therapeutic approaches, where the drug selection, development of adverse reactions, and etiological processes are going to be in an individualized manner. I must thank once again the Tamil Nadu IAP for inviting me to this prestigious Pudumai or a Puduvai Pedicord. Thank you. Shall I stop sharing? Hello? Hello? Hello, I have completed.